by Carl Willie. It is gone, a grand slam home run.
Running through my life.
In center field is going to be a base hit. A base hit by Jimmy Qualls, and it breaks up the perfect game.
9:07 on September 24th, the Mets have won the championship of the Eastern Division of the National League.
To get there, A.G. is going, and A.G.
The history of New York Mets baseball. An amazing era. New York City, 1957. Like any other American city during that era, things were rather simple back then, and less costly, too. A ride on the buses or subways only cost 15 cents, and an orchestra seat on Broadway went for $8. As a people, New Yorkers loved their baseball. So when the Dodgers announced that they were abandoning their loyal fans in Brooklyn to go west to Los Angeles, and the rival Giants from Manhattan followed suit and fled to San Francisco, New Yorkers were crushed. A city that had long been a National League town was left without a team.
New York without two teams, at least two teams, would have been, I think, a sports disaster for us. I got together some people to see what we could do, to spend some time to see whether we could get another team in here. We saw that we were having a great deal of difficulty in the expansion problem, but then we got around to start another league.
That idea was the brainchild of Bill Shea, a prominent New York attorney who headed up the four-man search committee, which pressed for the formation of the third league.
Well, today was the birth of the Continental League. The five founding teams consisting of New York, Toronto, Minneapolis, St. Paul, Denver, and Houston met here in New York and announced the formation of this new league.
And that, I think, frightened the owners enough in the National League to decide they'd better expand, have another club.
The recipients of the franchise included the team's chairman of the board, M. Donald Grant, and the majority stockholder and principal owner, Mrs. Joan Whitney Payson. Not only was Payson one of the world's richest women, she was also a knowledgeable baseball fan, and one of her first important decisions was to name former Yankees general manager George Weiss as the team's president.
I think George Weiss realized what the fans wanted in his drafting. He drafted a lot of name players, the Hodges and people, Don Zimmer, who the New York fans could associate with. Well, his idea of bringing back familiar faces to the New York fans, it was obvious that he felt that New York at the beginning would welcome these people back, and they did.
New Yorkers welcomed their National League team with open arms, giving them a ticker tape parade even before they played their first home game. The enthusiastic greeting befit a city starved for National League baseball and was an indication of the amazing fan support the Mets would later enjoy. Another reason for the tremendous interest in the team was ex-Yankee manager Casey Stengel's return to New York baseball. Casey was named the Mets manager in September of 61, and as spring training opened at Miller Huggins Field in 62, he was already in peak form.
Players, you are representing New York City, where there are great opportunities, especially in baseball. I realize what a great city it is because of the fact that I played on three major league cities in New York. And it's been outstanding the way every player on this team is put out in this spring training camp. And if you can continue that way the rest of your life, you're all going to be successful in baseball.
One thing I learned from Casey was he had something nice and kind to say to everybody, and he was always good with the media. He was always would be courteous and give as much time as he possibly could to them. But his relationship and communication with the players, even at his age, was just remarkable. Hopefully, I've learned something from him.
I love Casey as a person, and also love Casey as a manager, because he taught me things that the little small things that you have to do every day to make you a better pitcher and to make you a better player.
I think Casey was a very bright, quick guy. I think that Casey talked in his so-called Stengelese, my interpretation of what Stengelese is, and Casey didn't always speak in Stengelese, but my interpretation of what Stengelese was is that Casey was thinking about what he was saying, then he'd think about what he wanted to say next.
But in modern baseball, very few men can go 9 innings. It's a serious thing, and it's their handicap. They got a lively ball, you've got where the ball goes through the infielders quicker, and they go and strike these short fences, and now they got men on bases all the time.
Now he'd still be talking about the first subject, but he'd be thinking about the second one. Well, then he'd jump to the second one, and then while he was in the second one, he'd remember he didn't finish the first one.
He likes to pitch, he wants to pitch, and he isn't frightened about pitching, and he don't show excitement. So he steadied down more as the season progressed, so I'd have to say that's the big three.
Casey Stengel, God love him, he invented the term, the My Amazing Mets, or The Amazing Mets, and look at how it's amazing. I mean, you get two hits and he'd say it's amazing, you know. They did, they scored a run, it's amazing. That was Casey. Not that they won a ball game. That would be amazing too when that happened.
Led by the inimitable Casey, the Mets opened their inaugural season in St. Louis on April 11th, 1962.
This is Bob Murphy welcoming you to the first regular season game in the history of the New York Mets. Tonight, the New York Mets meet the St. Louis Cardinals right here in St. Louis.
The Mets' first batter was Richie Ashburn, who went on to become the team's MVP in 62. But despite everyone's best efforts, the Cardinals spoiled the opener, winning 11-4. 2 days later, the Mets came home to the Polo Grounds, where a disappointing crowd of just under 12,000 people came out in the rain, only to get a glimpse of what would follow throughout the year in the Pirates' 4-3 win. Finally, 10 days later in Pittsburgh on April 23rd, the Mets broke their string of 9 straight losses as Jay Hook pitched them to their first win, 9-1, over the Pirates. Winning, however, did not become a habit, as the Mets lost a record 120 games in 1962. Yet amazingly, still drew close to 1 million fans to the Polo Grounds. The next year was much the same story, except that ex-Dodger great Duke Snider was brought home to add some excitement.
And he throws this one deep to right, going, it's a home run! The Mets win by a score of 3-2. The Mets win it 3-2 on Snider's home run into the upper deck in right field. Hey, listen to that crowd. For a finish. This crowd up and cheering at the Polo Grounds.
Unfortunately, there wasn't too much to cheer about at the Polo Grounds in those early years. With a less than dazzling array of talent, the amazing Mets of Choo Choo Coleman and Hot Rod Keneal staggered through their first two seasons.
It got to a point where we'd come to the ballpark and we'd say, well, gee, how are we going to lose today? You know, it was contagious. That's exactly what it was.
One Met who certainly caught the disease was Marv Thornberry, whose opinion of his play differed from those around him.
I was sitting in the clubhouse, and Marv came over, and he said, Jay, you're an engineer, aren't you? And I said, yeah. And he said, well, engineers can print real good, can't they? And I said, yeah, I took some drafting classes. And he went over, and he took the sign from above his locker, and he turned it over, and we got a felt-tip pen, and he said, and this was, he made this up. He said, write Marvelous Marv on this card, would you? So I printed Marvelous Marv on this card that was above the locker, you know, those big cards. cards that have names on. Then he put it back above his locker. He turned it over and slid it back in, and it said Marvelous Marv. And after the game, the writers came in, and they were gathered around his locker. They looked up, and here was Marvelous Marv above his locker as they were talking with him. And I think from that point on, I think he was called Marvelous Marv.
Things weren't so marvelous for the rest of the Mets either. And at the end of the 63 season, they bid farewell to the Polo Grounds and headed off to Queens. Their new home was a stadium in Flushing Meadow, on which ground was broken a few years earlier.
I was budget director in 1960. At that time, a proposal came up to build a stadium in Queens, which subsequently became the Shea Stadium. And at that time, as budget director, you sit in as an advisor to the Board of Estimate. And everyone except two board members opposed it. The two were from the Bronx.
Built despite the dissenting votes, the facility was hailed as the most modern in baseball and called Shea Stadium in honor of Bill Shea, the man most responsible for bringing National League Baseball back to New York.
2 weeks after we opened the stadium, I was coming in and seeing somebody, two fellas in the back seat back of me. One fella said to the other one, "Who the heck was that guy Shea that they named the stadium?" "Oh," he said, "he was an old ball player, got killed in the First World War." So that kind of puts you back as to what you think you are.
Shea Stadium opened on April 17, 1964, directly across from the site of the New York World's Fair. And it was as well attended as any of the fair's events. That was somewhat amazing, too, because the Mets were still anything but world beaters on the field. Off it, however, they were about as entertaining as any losing team could be, constantly coming up with innovations like baseball's first mascot, Mr. Met.
He needed a live one, so I was selling tickets down at Grand Central, and they decided that they would audition me for the part of Mr. Met. So we came up with the papier-mâché, and Mr. Met was born. So I don't think there was an audition involved. It was just they gave me the ball and let me and let me run with it. You know, it just became a marriage right away, Mr. Met.
That same year, another marriage took place between Met fans and Ron Hunt, a scrappy second baseman who had an uncanny knack for giving up his body and getting hit by the pitch. As Hunt fast became the Mets' first full-time star, Met fans appreciated his hustle and Hunt appreciated their support.
Heck, it had to pump you up. And them being young and most of us being young, you know, we were all kind of there together, just trying to find a place for ourselves.
In 1964, Hunt found a place for himself as the National League's starting second baseman in the All-Star game. That year, the game was played at Shea and won by the National League when the Phillies' Johnny Callison hit a homer in the bottom of the ninth. There were other memorable moments in the new stadium's first season, like June 21st, 1964, when the Mets found themselves on the wrong end of a history-making event. Although the Mets weren't always the ones making the headlines, the fans kept coming out to see them and they kept having a good time while they were there.
I always felt it was fun to go to a Mets game, and the fans really got into it. The fans were just about as much a part of that ball game and as part of the entertainment as the game was itself. But the fans got caught up in it, and the fans started bringing these banners and signs, and the fans would actually enjoy themselves. They were having a good time at the ball game.
That was quickly becoming the key to Mets baseball. Whether it was unfurling a banner or reveling in a great play, there was no better time than the time at Shea. The tenor of the Mets didn't change much in 1965, even though new young talents like Ron Swoboda began to provide some hope. In 65, the highly touted Swoboda made everyone forget about his rocky fielding when he hit a Met rookie record, 19 home runs. Meanwhile, Ed Cranepool, who had joined the team as a 17-year-old from the Bronx in 1962, took over as the Mets' starting first baseman, a position he would hold on and off for many years to come. But the Mets still lost a lot more than they won. And during the summer, they even lost Casey. A broken hip forced the Mets' ultimate press agent to turn the managing of the team over to Wes Westrum,
thus ending an era in which the Mets lost over 100 games each year, but won over a lot of fans who would remain with them forever. Although the Mets wouldn't achieve success on the field until 1969, the building of their championship team actually took place in the three preceding years. Cleon Jones, perhaps one of the best hitters the Mets ever had, graduated from the farm system to become a regular fixture in the outfield in 1966, the same year that Jerry Grody arrived in a trade with the Houston Astros. Grody gave the Mets the man behind the plate they had sought for years and endured for a dozen seasons as one of the league's top defensive catchers. Then there was Bud Harrelson, the smaller-than-life shortstop, who himself became a starter in 1967, another one of the Mets' homegrown talents.
I felt that when more players like myself would get to the big leagues, we would show people that we were an organization on the move, an organization building from the foundation up.
That foundation became even more solid with the addition of Tom Seaver in 1967. Seaver had become a Met when the team picked his name out of a hat in a special draft a year earlier, and almost immediately took over as the Mets' number one pitcher. Seaver won 16 games in 67 and was named the Rookie of the Year as the Mets slowly built a winning team.
I think I was just part of a group of young players that came along to the Mets at one time and really changed their fortune. The biggest factor, of course, was when Gil Hodges came over in 1968. That was the one thing that turned the organization around.
Gil seemed to come in with a set plan and some enthusiasm about what we could do to win. And I think that was conveyed to the players, and we took on his confidence in us.
The same year Hodges took charge as the Mets manager, Jerry Kuzman became the team's top left-handed starter. Kuzman had been close to being cut in each of the two previous seasons, but by 68, he was pitching at Shea.
I pitched the opener. The first inning had bases loaded with nobody out, and Willie Mays is the hitter. And I remember saying to myself, you know, what's a farm boy from Minnesota doing in a fix like this? But anyway, end up striking Willie Mays out and popped up Jim Rehart to Jerry Grody, catcher, and struck out Jack Hyatt, and we went on to win 3-0. And in New York, in front of a full house, it was very pleasing to start the season off that way, both, I think, for the players and the fans.
1968 was also the first year fans at Shea were able to enjoy Tommy Agee. The Mets acquired Agee in a trade with the Chicago White Sox to play center field. And although he had a bad start at first, Hodges stuck with him, and Agee eventually straightened out. The Mets and their fans might not have realized it at the time, but all the pieces were in place for the most amazing year of all. It's hard to pinpoint the exact time at which the previously hapless Mets became contenders. In fact, they actually lost to the Montreal Expos in the expansion team's very first game. But on June 3rd, the Mets won over the 500 mark for the first time that late in the season. And on June 15th, they acquired Don Clendenin, who became the slugging first baseman they desperately needed to drive in some runs. Clendenin, in fact, drove in the lead or winning run in his first 16 games as a Met. And by the beginning of July, the race was really on. The competition came from the Chicago Cubs, a team made up of veteran players who were trying to erase years of heartache themselves. The first meaningful meeting between the Eastern Division's two top teams took place at Shea Stadium on July 8th, and the second place Mets, handcuffed all day by the first place Cubs ace pitcher Ferguson Jenkins, rallied for an amazing win in the bottom of the ninth.
Absolute bedlam here at Shea Stadium.
It was absolute bedlam the next night, too, when Tom Seaver pitched what was perhaps the greatest Met game ever. For 8 1/3 innings, Seaver thrilled a record crowd of over 58,000 people by flirting with perfection.
And it's hit hard to left center field. It's going to be a base hit. A base hit by Jimmy Qualls, and it breaks up the perfect game. Now the applause for Tom Seaver. 8 1/3 innings of perfect baseball by Seaver.
At that point, I think the Cubs started to say, you know, we're not going to coast into it. There's a young ball club on the rise, and of course, they're not going to give up. And Leo DeRocher didn't believe it in the beginning, but of course, I think later on, I think they heard the footsteps coming.
The footsteps finally arrived in September, when the Mets used a dash of black magic and a pinch of good luck to catch the Cubs.
Going into right field, A.G. is going to try and score. It's going to be close at the plate. The throw to slide. Save. Save
the plate.
Oh, what an argument.
Randy didn't tag me, you know. And, of course, he says he does. But only he and I will ever know what really happened there.
What happened after that was no mystery to anyone. Two nights later, the Mets vaulted into first place and followed that a short time later with a doubleheader sweep in Pittsburgh, in which the Mets' starting pitchers drove in the lone runs in both 1-0 wins.
I think in 1969, there was a lot of magic. I mean, you can't deny the fact that there was something happening to the team and to the baseball in general. I don't know, maybe there was a spiritual something happening to us, but if you want to say it was magic, it was magic.
Ground ball is short. This could be it. There's one. There's two. The game is over. The Mets are the champion. At 9:07 on September 24th, the Mets have won the championship of the Eastern Division of the National League. Look at that scene. They can't hold the fans. The Mets are being swamped. The Mets are being swamped. They've lost their cap. Gentry's cap is gone. The Met fans are pouring into the dugout. They're all over the
field. Here's the guy that causes all the trouble, Tom Seaver, and Tom's front of the ball. Congratulations, Tom, on a great year.
Rob is great. It's a third of what we want. We hope we get the rest of it. That's all.
Well, I think you guys have got a tremendous spirit, and you were the leader of it all when you got them all thinking you could win and go on and go right to the top.
I hope so. We got the greatest bunch of guys you've ever seen, and we're just a bunch of young kids that love to play this game. It's terrific.
Trouble is, you guys never have any fun.
It was spontaneous. It was new to all these players. They had never been involved in anything like that. The clubhouse was crazy because it finally happened. After all those years, the Mets won.
After clinching their first divisional title ever, the Mets continued their improbable search for the impossible dream by taking on the Atlanta Braves in the first National League Championship Series. Surprisingly, it was no contest, as the Mets swept three games from the Braves.
Out to third, Garrett has the ball, a throw to first, and the Mets are the National League champions.
Not surprisingly, the whole city was mesmerized by the Mets. From ninth place also-rans in 1968 to National League champions in 1969, the Mets were amazing.
I believe the New York Mets are amazing, 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 amazing.
Amazing!
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 Amazing! Amazing!
It's just amazing.
Amazing or not, the Mets found themselves in the World Series against what many considered a vastly superior Baltimore Oriole team. And when Tom Seaver surrendered a home run to the Orioles' leadoff man, Don Buford, things didn't look too good.
He said as he went by, "You guys ain't seen nothing yet." I said, "Well, you know, first inning, first game, you ain't seen nothing yet either."
Harrelson, of course, was right. The next day, with Jerry Kuzman firing a no-hitter for six innings, the Mets rebounded from their 4-1 loss in Game 1. Repeatedly pulling out of the hat the kinds of plays that propelled them to the pennant, the Mets scored a run in the top of the ninth and went on to win their first World Series game ever, 2-1. The series shifted to Shea for Game 3, and from then on, the results were nothing but amazing. All year long, the Mets had continually thrilled their fans with their overachieving effort, and the series proved to be no different. Especially the fourth inning of Game 3, when Tommy Agee saved the day the first time.
There's a drive in the deep left center, racing hard as
energy.
Later in the seventh inning, with the game on the line again, A.G. did it again.
And it is a fly ball that will be tough to get to. A.G. is going, and A.G. makes
a diving catch. Keyed by A.G.'s two fantastic catches, the Mets shut down the Orioles in Game 3, 5-0. Then with Seaver clinging to a 1-0 lead in the ninth inning of Game 4, Ron Swoboda took his turn on center stage.
As I rolled over, I kind of, you know, looked in there, and there it was. And I can remember at the time saying, boy, you just made one hell of a catch here, and this is a World Series.
Swoboda was right about his catch. He was thinking the same thing as everyone else. And amazing as his catch was, it also kept the Mets in the game until J.C. Martin stepped to the plate in the bottom of the 10th with Rod Gaspar on second.
To bunt. Bunts the ball, a good one. It's taken now by Rickett. Throws to first, trying to hit him in the back. Here comes the winning run. The Mets win the ball game. The Mets win the ball game by a score of 2-1.
The Mets were now just one win away from completing the most miraculous baseball season ever, and Jerry Koosman was handed the opportunity to do it. But in the third inning, Koosman unexpectedly gave up two home runs, the latter a solo shot to Frank Robinson.
It's gone.
After Frank Robinson hit that home run, I came back in the dugout and I says, boys, I was kind of mad. I said, I'll hold them right there. They're not getting any more. Let's go beat them.
And beat them they did. First, Don Clendenin, later to be named the series MVP, hit a two-run homer in the sixth inning to close the gap to 3-2. And then, in the bottom of the seventh, Al Weiss hit his first homer at Shea all season to pull the Mets even. One inning later, the Mets scored twice to take the lead for good. And then with two out in the ninth, Davey Johnson ironically provided the final obstacle.
Fly ball, deep left field. Jones is back to the fence. Jones is on the warning track. The World Series is over. Jones takes the net.
What was going through my mind at that time is we are world champions. You know, irreversible. No one can take it away. Unbelievable.
Most of us couldn't talk. We were so choked up.
It was a heaven before heaven.
Wonder of wonders, miracle of miracles, God took a Daniel once again. Stood by his side and miracle of miracles, walked him through the lion's den. Wonder of wonders, miracle of miracles, God took a tailor by the hand. Turned him around and miracle of miracles, led him to the promised land.
It's a celebration. I mean, you're sort of saying, hey, folks, get off on this.
But of all God's miracles, large and small, the most miraculous one of all is the one I thought could never be. God has given you to me.
Just 8 years after they had stood on the steps of City Hall as baseball's bumbling babes, the Mets now stood before the world as champions. And as the city rejoiced, the Mets enjoyed the spotlight.
Well, look who's assembling on our stage. Here they are, ladies and gentlemen. Here they are, the champion Mets, singing, You've Gotta Have Heart. So let's have a fine...
You can be a hero.
to do it. You gotta have heart. Miles and miles and miles of heart. Oh, it's fine to be a genius, of course. But beat that old horse before the car. First, you gotta have heart.
We captured the whole country that year. We were the underdogs, and the country was, the mentality of the whole country that was really stirred up at that time. There was a lot of things going on in the world.
It really kind of stopped everybody thinking about the bad things, and for a very brief period of time, made everybody think along some good lines.
If the Mets can do it, the rest of the world's going to be all right. You know, it was that attitude. So that was, it was a wonderful time.
While the memories of the Mets' miracle year lingered, the first place finishes didn't. The Mets followed their amazing championship season with two consecutive third-place finishes. And then, tragically, just before the 1972 season was to begin, Gil Hodges was stricken with a massive heart attack and died. The team was devastated, but the organization moved quickly to announce that longtime Met coach Yogi Berra would take over as Hodges' successor. Berra and the Mets only finished third again that year, but all wasn't lost for Met fans. In May, the already legendary Willie Mays returned to New York and unbelievably homered against his former teammates in his very first game. Optimism returned to Shea in 73, but the Mets were crippled with injuries. Bud Harrelson, Cleon Jones, John Milner, and George the Stork Theodore all went down for long stretches. And despite the addition of quality players like Felix Mian, the Mets found themselves floundering in last place. But as the fans spent the summer wondering just who to blame, the Mets' fortune suddenly changed.
M. Donald Grant comes down to have a clubhouse meeting, and his talk was on how the front office still believes in the players. We think of all you guys as family. We love every one of you. You wouldn't be here. And we have confidence in you. We know you can turn this thing around if you'll just believe in yourselves, you know? And I said, you gotta believe! Yeah, that's right! You gotta believe! Right in the middle of his talk. That night, we won the game. I got the save. And we were talking to the press afterwards, and the story came out, and you gotta believe. Then we started getting that in the articles, and it was headlines. And next thing you know, we went on a roll, and that became our rally cry.
From then on, the Mets started winning, and in a game on September 20th against the Pirates, with the Mets on the verge of moving into first place, the ghosts of miracles past returned to Shea.
Into the air to left field, it's deep. Back goes Jones by the fence. It hits the top of the fence. Comes back in play, Jones grabs it. The relay throw to the plate, they may get him. He's out.
From that point on, we just, the next day we went out and we beat them bad, and we had it the whole rest of the way. It was the most together I've ever seen people get in my career. We just became a unit. It was one of the best periods of my life.
Now the stretch by McGraw, the 3-2 delivery, the runner goes, and a little pop-up. Milner grabs it, he'll run to first, double play, the Mets win the pennant. The Mets have just won the pennant in the Eastern Division.
With one of the most amazing comebacks in baseball history now complete, the Mets faced the Cincinnati Reds in the championship series. And after splitting two games in Cincinnati, things really heated up in New York in game three.
The first double play, fight breaks out, Pete Rose and Buddy Harrelson.
Well, I popped up a little bit in Cincinnati after Matlack's game. Made a silly statement that the Reds looked like me hitting. I didn't think it was all that bad. I was kind of putting myself down a little bit, but I was also putting them down. Then I heard that they were going to come after me and all that, so I figured that was it right there. And when Pete hit me after I'd already thrown the ball, I got mad. And then we had the little match. He just kind of lifted me up and laid me down to sleep, and it was all over. You know, I keep telling everybody I made him famous.
The Mets went on to win that game 9-2. And the next day, George Stone, who had joined the Mets in the same trade as Felix Mian, valiantly tried to close out the Reds. But Rose's homer won it in extra innings, and the Mets had to wait another day before finishing off Cincinnati.
That McGraw gets the sign, goes into the motion. Here's a two-strike pitch. Swung on, hit on the ground toward first. Milner has the ball. Flips to McGraw.
So the always improbable Mets were back in the World Series for the second time in 5 years. And once again, they weren't given much of a chance to come out on top. This time, their opponents were the overpowering Oakland A's, a team of budding and established superstars out to defend the world championship they won the previous year. The A's squeaked out a 2-1 win in game one. And in the 10th inning of a tie game the next day, the Mets were sure they had taken a big step towards getting even.
Not too deep. Rudy's there. Tagging is Harrelson. Will he gamble? He's coming. Here's the throw. And he is out at home plate. He's out.
Ultimately, Yogi and the rest of the irate Mets lost the argument. But Berra wouldn't be too upset for long. In the top of the 12th, the Mets rallied for 4 runs, helped in part by A's second baseman Mike Andrews' 2 errors and Willie Mays' final hit in the majors. The Mets' 10-7 win was not artistic, but it was critical, and the team's return to Shea. The A's won game 3, but the Mets bounced back the next night. Rusty Staub homered in the first inning and drove in 5 of the team's 6 runs, playing despite a severely injured shoulder. On the mound, John Matlack avenged his opening game loss by winning the crucial 4th game, 6-1. The next night, Jerry Kuzman shut out the A's for 6 1/3 innings, and Tug McGraw followed with 2 2/3 innings of scoreless relief himself, as the Mets blanked the A's 2-0 and took a 3-2 lead back to Oakland. But unlike 1969, the Mets' amazing march to the top in 1973 came up 1 game short.
So you gotta believe took us almost. It took us to the 7th game anyway, and then we lost it. I remember at the end, it was frustrating that we'd gone so far, and we're right there, and let it slip away.
The upbeat attitude surrounding the Mets after their 1973 championship season vanished soon after the next one began. In fact, no one has ever suggested that the Mets got off to a flying start in 1974. While they no doubt didn't realize it at the time, opening day was the harbinger of the bad times ahead, as Mike Schmidt of the Phillies hit a 2-run homer off Tug McGraw in the bottom of the 9th to overtake the Mets 5-4, and things didn't improve a lot thereafter.
I think when we lost the World Series, I think it took the heart out of the organization, because a lot of players, after coming so far and coming from such adversity of having a bad year and getting into the World Series, we expected to win the World Series, and when we didn't, somebody popped our bubble.
McGraw himself had his bubble burst too. And for the author of the previous year's rallying cry, his 9th year with the Mets turned out to be his last.
I didn't like leaving the Mets behind because at the time, because it was like I was getting thrown out. Damaged goods, we don't want you anymore. And all the years, all through the years, it was always family. And Mrs. Payson and Johnny Murphy and all those people were gone. It was like, gee, everything's cold and cut and dry now. And I felt real uncomfortable with that, real disappointed. It was a growing up. It was like, oh, guess what, Tug? Welcome to the real world.
While some of the familiar Met stars were leaving, new talent like Dave Kingman was appearing on the scene. Kingman arrived with a bang at the beginning of the 75 season and hit 36 home runs that year and 37 the next. Meanwhile, Tom Seaver followed an off year in 74 with his 3rd Cy Young in 75, and Mike Vail provided some hope when he embarked on a rookie record-tying 22-game hitting streak late in the year. The Mets, though, still finished a respectable 3rd that year and again the next, as Rusty Staub became the first Met ever to drive in over 100 runs. But as things turned out, Staub's days in a Met uniform were numbered.
I promise you that no one wants to play in New York and with the Mets more than I do. It seemed like it was obvious to me that my chances of playing in 76 were going to be remote. I didn't even renew my lease in my apartment. I moved everything back to Houston because I really felt that they were going to trade me, and they did.
Unfortunately, there were changes in the Mets' immediate family, too. A few days after the 1975 season, Casey Stengel, the longtime symbol of the early Mets, passed away. And shortly thereafter, the Mets also lost Joan Payson. With the passing of the team's original owner, the Mets lost someone who had been with them since the very beginning, and the management of the team was shifted to her daughter, Lorinda Durolet. The Mets' new owner then allowed Chairman of the Board, M. Donald Grant, a much freer hand in the operation of the team. And in their first season, the new regime saw Jerry Kuzman, a favorite of the fans for years, win 20 games.
The ball game is over. Kuzman has his 20th win of the year. He has struck out 13. He is being embraced by spirits now. Everyone.
They also saw Wayne Garrett's last year in New York. Garrett played 709 games in a Mets uniform, more than any other third baseman. And if you don't think that's much of an accomplishment, consider that in their history, the Mets have seen 86 different players at third. The Mets' third base troubles actually paled in comparison to the ones they endured during the 1977 season. To say things didn't go smoothly that year might be something of an understatement. Not only did the Mets land in last place again, but 1977 was also the year that the simmering troubles between pitcher Tom Seaver and chairman of the board M. Donald Grant came to a head. For some time now, Seaver had been dissatisfied with both his contract and the way the team had been run. Then on June 12th, in a game against Houston in the Astrodome, Tom Seaver pitched what many thought would be his last time in a Mets uniform. True to form, he won. It was his 191st victory for the Mets. But 3 days later, Tom Seaver was on his way to Cincinnati.
As far as the fans go, I mean, I've given them a great number of thrills, and they've been equally returned. And the ovation I got the other night.
You going to miss them, Tom?
Not only would Seaver miss the fans would miss him. And the same could be said of Dave Kingman, who was also traded the same night. It was an emotional transformation, and June 15th, 1977 will forever be remembered as the Midnight Massacre.
Come on, George. You know, I think if the organization could have had the same kind of leadership they had when Gil was there, the same kind of strength that they had when Gil was there, definitely I would have wanted to stay there. But I just didn't enjoy the man I was working for.
For whatever the reason, the facts were irreversible and undeniable. Tom Seaver, the man they called the franchise, was gone. More than any other player in Mets history, Seaver's name had become synonymous with the team's success. Statistically, he was head and shoulders above any other Met pitcher. With his 420 win seasons, 3 Cy Young awards, and 19 strikeouts in one game. But even more than that, Tom Seaver and the Mets seemed to grow up together, and his loss was hard to take, not only for his fans, but for his teammates too.
Tom was really the franchise at that time, and had been. And for them to trade Tom, it was like as though the worth of the rest of us wasn't that much either. If they were going to trade him, they would probably trade us at the drop of a pin.
I saw my friends, people that I had grown up with, played a number of years, getting traded, people coming into an organization that really couldn't play.
I didn't see any improvement coming for the Mets organization. And so I asked to be traded.
By 1978, almost all of the Mets from the championship era were gone, and a younger group of players had taken their place. The man in charge was Joe Torre, who had replaced Joe Frazier as manager in the early part of the 77 season. Torrey's lineup included several players the Mets had obtained in the Seaver trade. Doug Flynn provided excellent defense at second base, where he won a Gold Glove Award. While Steve Henderson took over in left field and finished second in the Rookie of the Year balloting in 1977. Another player obtained in the Seaver trade was pitcher Pat Zachary. But there were some other Mets who carried the team for the rest of the 70s, like Craig Swan, who led the league in ERA in 1978, and John Stearns, who made the All-Star team twice before the end of the decade. But the Mets' real hope during that time was Lee Mazzilli, a Brooklyn-born outfielder with matinee-idol looks and an apparent abundance of talent, who was the team's number one draft choice in 1973.
I was on the field and they won the pennant in 69 and looking at it and say, this is a big league ballpark. I imagine being in the plate, you know, and then I go back out there and here I am playing in the big leagues, playing in that exact center field and going to the plate and doing the things that I had fun doing. And visualizing that while I was out on the field during the game, saying, hey, you know, when I was 14 years old, I was running on the field. And that's a nice feeling to have.
Unfortunately for Maz and the Mets, there weren't too many of those nice feelings going around in the late 70s when the team finished last 3 years in a row. And as the losses mounted and the attendance dropped, Shea Stadium became a far different place than it had once been.
It used to really hurt to come in and play against the Mets and see 6, 7, 10,000 people sitting in the stands, because I knew, and it really hurt to hear the ball players say, oh, we got to go to New York and play. And I said, don't you guys know how great of a town this is to play in?
The Mets had come full circle and for the moment looked more like their 1962 counterparts than any Met team from the recent past. That had become consistent and powerful pennant contenders in the National League didn't come together overnight. Credit for the Mets' comeback goes back to 1980, when the team was sold by the Duralays for the then staggering price of $21 million to a group headed by majority owner Nelson Doubleday.
Well, we always felt that New York was a National League city, and that with a little time and effort and a couple of bucks, we could turn it around and make them successful again. The Mets, historically, for all their 25 years, really have drawn a lot of people, and they'd kind of let the franchise get dormant on them, and so we thought there was a wonderful opportunity here.
The importance of baseball to this community, to the fiber and fabric of this community, is as important perhaps as any other one aspect.
Critical to any team is a shrewd, canny general manager, and in Frank Cashin, the Mets secured a respected baseball man who relished a challenge.
The fact that the franchise was kind of really disleveled at that point in time. Their farm system was kind of drained. They had finished last or next to last for 4 or 5 consecutive years. And I guess I just couldn't resist the opportunity to at least try to turn it around.
For a while, the magic was back at Shea. And there were even brief periods when the Mets made people believers again. Like the night Steve Henderson hit a dramatic game-winning homer in the ninth inning to stun the Giants during a summer when the Mets played close to 500 ball before finally fading out of the race. Slowly but surely, the Mets were showing signs of making a comeback. Neil Allen completed 3 outstanding seasons and was recognized as one of the league's top relievers, while John Stearns made the All-Star team 2 more times. Most importantly, the Mets were building a solid foundation from within. And nowhere was that more evident than in the play of 2 of their more popular players, Hubie Brooks and Mookie Wilson. But Cashin still felt the team needed outside help.
It gives me great pleasure to introduce Sheila and George Foster.
George Foster was obtained in a trade with the Cincinnati Reds in 1982. and represented for Met fans a clear signal that the Doubleday regime was dedicated to rebuilding the franchise. Foster also gave the Mets a power hitter to go along with Dave Kingman, who had been reacquired in 1981. But miracles rarely happen overnight, and things were still tough for managers George Bamberger and Frank Howard, who saw their teams finish no better than fifth. Also during that period, Tom Seaver returned to Shea. The Mets had reacquired Seaver before the 1983 season, and on opening day, he pitched before an adoring crowd of close to 50,000 people. Seaver threw six innings of shutout ball in his return engagement, although he didn't get the win. But with Seaver pitching well and the Mets winning, it was like the good old days at Shea again. Meanwhile, down on the farm in Tidewater, the Mets were assembling a devastating group of talented minor leaguers who would soon arrive at Shea. There was outfielder Darryl Strawberry, the nation's number one draft pick in 1980, and overpowering Dwight Gooden, a pitcher with awesome potential. Ron Darling, acquired from Texas for Lee Mazzilli, helped as the Davy Johnson-led Tides won the Minor League World Series in 1983. But even though Cashin was intent on building from within, he didn't hesitate to acquire Keith Hernandez when the Cardinals made him available. Hernandez was a true star, day in and day out, something the Mets hadn't had for years. But for him, the trade was troubling at first.
Coming to the last place team, a team that had just been down for so long in the 70s, and it wasn't a great prospect. It wasn't something I was looking forward to, but I decided to give it some time and see what would happen. Frank Cashin told me there was the Dwight Goodens, the Darryl Strawberries, the Ron Darlings. I took Frank's word for it. He convinced me and I stayed, and it was the right decision.
As things turned out, it was the right decision for the Mets, too. Hernandez not only played outstanding defense on a daily basis, he also taught his younger teammates how to win.
Base hit left field. Here comes Wilson. Coleman can't come up with it. Mets win 7-6.
Keith's arrival came on the heels of Darryl Strawberry's, who was just up from Tidewater. Strawberry came to the majors with potential labeled unlimited, and he filled some of that potential right away when he hit 26 homers and was named the Rookie of the Year.
That's a great honor after the rough start I got off to. It's once in a lifetime you get a chance to win an honor like Rookie of the Year, and I'm very pleased to be a part of it.
Rusty Staub was also glad to be a part of the Mets' comeback. Staub had returned to the team in 1981 and became baseball's premier pinch hitter, especially in 1983 when his 24 pinch hits led the majors and his 25 pinch hit RBIs tied a major league record. Almost all the pieces for a winning team were now in place. All that was needed was someone to lead them, and Cashin found that man right within his organization, Davy Johnson.
We needed a younger manager, a manager that communicated perhaps a little better with the younger ball players, a manager that was not afraid to take a chance.
The biggest thing in 1984, I think, was using some young pitchers in the starting rotation, and I knew something that a lot of other people didn't know. I knew that Dwight Gooden was going to be on my staff and be my number one pitcher.
With the arrival of Dwight Gooden in 1984, Met fans could once again be awed by a pitcher of extraordinary ability. Like Tom Seaver had done 17 years before, Gooden, who would win the Cy Young Award in 1985, burst onto the scene with a maturity way beyond his years. His strikeout totals were truly unreal, 276 of them in his first season, which set a new major league rookie record. It was also Gooden who led the Mets in their unexpected challenge of the eventual division champion Chicago Cubs. In one amazing game down the stretch, Gooden did his best to keep the fading Mets in the race when he pitched a one-hit shutout against Chicago. Of course, Dr. K wasn't the only one creating excitement around Shea in 84. There was third baseman Hubie Brooks, a fan favorite who embarked on a team record-setting 24-game hitting streak during the month of May.
Base hit up the ladder, 24 in a row for Hubie Brooks. Let's listen to this crowd.
The young Mets were not only exciting baseball with their winning ways, they were also winning in exciting ways.
And Anderson's being sent home. Here's the throw to Fitzgerald. He's out! Chapman line drive, base hit, Mets win. Line drive, it's going to be in there for extra bases. One run is in, the game is tied. Here comes Gibbons, and Mets win.
Despite their newfound success, the Mets still came up short in 1984. So in 1985, in their attempt to rise even further, the Mets set out to find the final piece to their championship puzzle. Gary Carter was acquired from Montreal in a blockbuster, unexpected trade, bringing the best catcher in baseball to New York. Carter fit in well with his new team right away. His exuberance was refreshing, and his all-out rough-and-tumble style of play was not only exciting, but contagious. And then there was Carter's ability to perform in the clutch, a trait he exhibited in his very first game as a Met on opening day at Shea.
Another breaking ball, and this could be the ball game. Deep to left. Out of here. Gary Carter, a game-winning home run in the bottom of the 10th inning, and the Mets win on opening day 6-5. Welcome to New York, Gary Carter.
Acquiring Gary Carter, the last piece of the puzzle fit, and that's when in 1985 the ball club won 98 ball games and became a genuine contender.
Breaking ball off of Carter's glove, the throw, out at home! What a play by Jesse Orosco and Gary Carter!
Like a fine engine, all the parts were in place, and the Mets were primed and ready for 1986. The spring of 1986 was filled with more than the usual hopes and expectations. The squad that had come so close the season before was continuing in its process of maturation. Yet Mets management knew that the roster still needed to be fine-tuned. Over the winter, acquisitions were made. One move was for left-handed pitcher Bob Ojeda, picked up in a trade with the Boston Red Sox. Another deal brought infielder Tim Tuffle to New York from Minnesota. While from within, a promotion would be given to Kevin Mitchell, a versatile rookie full of talent. With changes made, the long race began through a season of promises to be kept. The wheel of fortune first turned in St. Louis as the Mets faced the arch-rival Cardinals. A key blow was struck on April 24th. It was the ninth inning of the series opener.
2-2 to Howard Johnson. The Mets need a long ball. They might have it. This ball is out of here, and this game is tied. Oh, my goodness. So much for fate.
It just kind of showed that the Cardinals, that we were going to be tough to beat. You know, in the previous year, they'd handle us pretty good early in the season, and we were showing them this year that we're going to handle them.
We'd be in the next three games fairly handily, and their season went down the hill after that. I think they had so much emotion in that series that after we beat them four straight, that just eliminated them from any kind of contention.
Finishing April with an 11-game winning streak, the Mets had vaulted into first place in the National League East. From there, the 1-2 punch of Lenny Dykstra and Wally Backman continued to ignite a club that refused to yield its hold on the top spot. Putting hustle into muscle, Dykstra and Backman weren't pretty, but they got the job done. Say the same for Kevin Mitchell, an amazing rookie who took care of business at six different positions in 86. Day in, day out leadership came from Keith Hernandez, consistent at bat and in the field, as well as from the kid, Gary Carter, who tied a club record with 105 runs batted in. Another power source was Daryl Strawberry, who lit up pitchers along with Ray Knight, a man with a knack for the big hit. In all, these Mets had the league's best offense, quality matched by the men on the hill. Mets pitchers kept matters well in hand all year long. Newcomer Bob Ojeda exceeded even the most optimistic predictions with a team-leading 18 wins and a 2.57 earned run average, second best in the National League. A similar impact was made by imposing Sid Fernandez. El Cid sizzled much of the summer, reaching a career high with 200 strikeouts, fourth best in a league that had to learn about him the hard way.
Look out, world. Here comes a kid from Hawaii. He's the first 12-game winner in the National League.
Meanwhile, the Mets' other Hawaiian native, pitcher Ron Darling, had an impressive year of his own. Darling endeared himself to New York with 15 wins and 21 decisions while posting a 2.81 ERA, indicative of his sure-handed control. But the best sign of Mets' success was the surgical precision of Dr. K, Dwight Gooden, who became the first pitcher in history to strike out 200 or more batters in each of his first three seasons. With 17 wins, Gooden was plenty.
Ground ball to Gooden, to home, to first. Dwight Gooden with a 1-2-3 double play to end the ball game.
A solid complement to the starters were the boys in the bullpen, led by the righty-lefty tandem of Roger McDowell and Jesse Orozco. They could be counted on for a strong finish whenever pitching coach Mel Stottlemyre needed to dial a little relief. McDowell set a club record with 75 appearances while racking up 22 saves. At the same time, Orozco notched 21 of his own, surpassing Tug McGraw as the Mets' all-time leader in saves. In a year of good news, Lee Mazzilli's return to New York was one of the toppers. After a four-year hiatus, Maz came back to the Mets in August. It was a homecoming worthy of celebration.
Here's a drive off Mazzilli's bat. Gone, Lee Mazzilli! And they love him even more at Shea Stadium now.
Taking over in the tradition of Ed Cranepool and Rusty Staub, Mazzilli provided leadership and timely pinch hits. Both qualities would be appreciated even more in October. But first, a glorious September when the Mets finished one chapter of the season and began another.
It's party time at Shea as 50,000 fans are generating their own electricity.
13 years of waiting.
Ground ball to second. Backman to Hernandez. The inevitable has finally become a reality. On September 17th, the New York Mets become champions of the National League's Eastern Division for 1986.
On to the Astrodome, home of the Western Division-winning Houston Astros. During the year, the Mets lost 4 of 6 in Houston, and nobody expected the league championship series to be a walkover. Proof of that came courtesy of Mike Scott. One of the year's most dominant pitchers, Scott struck out 14 en route to a shutout. The deciding hit, Glenn Davis's home run as Houston defeated New York 1-0 in the Mets' first postseason game in 13 years. But manager Davey Johnson could take comfort the next night as Keith Hernandez and company were making life a little uncomfortable for Nolan Ryan. Already up 3-0 in the fifth, the Mets had Dykstra on third and Backman on second with Hernandez looking fastball all the way. One run scores, and quickly another. The New Yorkers staked themselves to a commanding 5-0 lead on the strength of Hernandez's triple. Now en route to a decisive win, the Mets returned home with a split. Stricken with pennant fever, the city was totally taken by the Mets ball club. The electricity was turned on at Shea Stadium for Game 3, a memorable Saturday afternoon. An early 4-run Astro advantage didn't still the crowd. In the sixth, the Mets rallied, a single blow coming from Darryl Strawberry. Straw stirred Shea to a frenzied pitch with a 3-run homer that tied the game 4-4 in the sixth inning. Fortune seesawed all day, as in the seventh when Houston took a 1-run lead. Down by 1 in the ninth, the home side held out hope as Lenny Dykstra prepared to face Astro reliever Dave Smith, with the potential tying run, Wally Backman on second.
Lenny Dykstra, the man they call Nails on the Mets ball club is waiting. Now the pitch, and a high fly ball hits the right field. It is fairly deep, it's way back by the wall.
He did it! It's a home run! A home run! The Mets win the ball game! Dykstra hits a home run! Lynn Dykstra hit a home run! This ball game is over!
Late inning heroics had become the hallmark of 1986.
Let's go, Mets! Let's go, Mets!
But the joy of Game 3 soon dissolved, thanks to another dose of former Met Mike Scott, whose split-fingered mastery brought New York up short again. A 3-1 Houston triumph had evened the series. Pivotal Game 5 went to extra innings, tied at 1. With the Mets batting in the bottom of the 12th, Gary Carter came up big. Wally Backman scampered home with the deciding run, and the New Yorkers were now just one victory away from the pennant. Back to Houston. Were the Mets turning their backs on opportunity? It seemed that way, down 3-0 in the first inning of Game 6. That score lasted into the 9th inning as the Astros seemed certain of forcing Game 7. But the only real certainty was New York's uncanny ability to come back. But the 9th inning was only the prelude to a truly amazing outcome. In the 14th, the Mets took a one-run lead. But now in the home half of the 14th, it was Houston's turn to come back as Jesse Orosco worked to Billy Hatcher.
At a high fly, deep to left, down the line, a big old foul waiting. It hits the screen. High ball game, home run.
In the 16th, the Mets scored 3 times. In the bottom of the inning, the Astros tallied twice and had 2 on with 2 out.
The pitch on the way, swing and a miss, swing and a miss, strike him out, Mets win it, the Mets have won it, oh, they are mobbing Jesse Orosco.
For the 3rd time in their amazing history, the Mets had captured a National League pennant.
It's just unbelievable. I don't have enough words to describe how great it is to be going to the World Series.
This is an awful happy bunch of guys out here. We, you know, we're just...
Resurgence and the fans coming back and bringing back a flag to the Met fans in New York. Oh, this is the greatest thing in the world. One more step. One more thing will top it, and it'll be a world championship.
Game 1 of the 1986 World Series got underway against the Boston Red Sox, fresh off a miracle finish of their own. And in this classic match of seasoned vets and raw recruits, it seemed like neither team could shake the first game jitters. Until that is the 7th inning, and a lonely Met mistake.
One down, the pitch, ground ball to second.
Tuffel has a go between his legs. Strawberry picks it up, here comes Rice. Throw coming to the plate to Carter, not in time. Throw to second, not in time. Red Sox lead.
1-0. The final and the series score, both in favor of the Sox. Game 2. The Mets had their number one pitcher on the mound, but Gooden wasn't good enough as the Red Sox pounded out a 9-3 decision, taking both the games at Shea and heading home with a 2-0 series lead. The dust had barely settled on the pregame entertainment when the Mets tipped the scales in their favor.
Number 4, Lenny Dykstra, center fielder.
Lenny Dykstra greased the squeaky wheel. And the Mets responded with a first inning explosion that put all talk of sweeping back under the Boston rug. Carter helped to fuel a 4-run first inning for the Mets, who dug deep and struck oil. That proved more than enough for Bobby Ojeda, who in his first trip back to Fenway Park stymied his former team and gave the Mets their first win of the series. The victory took a lot of pressure off the Mets, and in Game 4, they looked to Ron Darling to snag still another. Darling pitched 7 shutout innings, and the other half of the battery charged the Boston night with two towering home runs to spark a 6-2 Mets win and even the series at two games apiece. Game 5 in Boston, and some Red Sox glory from the past gave way to dreams of the present. As Bruce Hurst rose to the occasion by humbling the Mets for the second time in the series. The 4-2 win sent the series back to Shea, with a championship for Boston just one game away. It was, quite simply, an extraordinary game. One where high-flying Met fans displayed a most enterprising knack. And in the eighth, the Mets showed a talent for coming back.
Hands on their feet here at Shea. Bases loaded, one down. Red Sox lead 3-2. Swung on, hit in the air to left field. It'll be caught, runner tagged. Here comes Mazzilli. Here comes the throw to the plate. Not in time. The game is tied at 3-3.
Into the tenth, the tension mounted.
People have sit still the way this game is going. By far and away, the most intense game of the World Series. Now the windup, the pitch to Henderson, well hit, deep to left field, way back going, gone, a home run. The Red Sox are in front, 4-3.
The Sox would add another to make it 5-3. The celebration was on ice. Three outs were all they'd need.
Now the pitcher on the way, hit in the air, right, it's there, and has it for the out. And the Red Sox are two outs away from a championship. And a fly ball to center, Henderson going back under it now. He has it, two men down.
You know, I'd love to lie and say, yeah, you know, I knew we were going to come back. No one, I mean, everyone inside and everyone on the bench believed we had no chance. I mean, I believe that wholeheartedly, except for four guys, and Gary Carter, Kevin Mitchell, Ray Knight, and Mookie Wilson.
'Twas Carter who sparked a rally for the ages.
Lined into left field, base hit for Carter, and the Mets are still alive.
Mitchell was called on to pinch hit and kept the patient breathing. There was no margin for error on this long day's journey into night.
And that's going to be hit into center field, base hit. Here comes Carter to score, and the tying run is at third in Kevin Mitchell.
Leading now just 5-4, Boston called on Bob Stanley. His mission? Erase a budding hero named Mookie.
All I want to do is I don't want to strike out. And it so happens that Bob Stanley threw a wild pitch.
And it's going to go to the backstop. Here comes Mitchell to score the tying run. And Ray Knight is at second base.
Now, at that point, a big relief is on me now. I mean, I can't lose. There's nothing I can do to lose anymore. When I came to the plate, we were losing. And now I'm still at the plate, and all of a sudden, we're tied. I can't lose now, no matter what I do. So I just want to make contact.
Little roller up along first. Behind the bag. It gets through Buckner. Here comes Knight, and the Mets win it.
It was, you gotta believe, some 13 years later. And as always, amazing. Game 7 still had to be played, with the unbeatable Hurst against Darling. Early on, it appeared the Red Sox had recovered, but the Mets hung tough behind the exemplary relief of Sid Fernandez. Then in the sixth, the Mets began to chip away, with Carter reaching out to tie the game at 3. So it stood into the seventh, until Calvin Schiraldi faced series MVP Ray Knight. Both teams would score and score again, but the Mets would never trail. Then in the ninth, Jesse Orozco, and the Mets were champs once more. The Mets had once again captured the heart of the city as 2 million strong turned out to show their love. And with all the comebacks and high drama, this might have been the sweetest one of all. The calm after the storm. Opening day, 1987. First, there was the matter of jewelry to be dealt with. World Series rings befitting a team of desire, talent, and passion. The best team in all of baseball. And defense of that honor began in typical Daryl Strawberry fashion. The Mets won their opening game in 1987, but their fortune soon began to slide. All the little things that went so right the year before, this year began to run afoul.
Another breaking ball skied to left. And this ball is gonna, it hit a bird!
You believe that?
Bird! I've never seen that.
Off the glove of McDowell, kicks away. Can he make it? Oh, everybody's safe. How do you like that? And McDowell threw the ball away. Oh, what a crazy play.
But no more sour note was struck than to the pitching staff. Bob Ojeda went on the disabled list, and Sid succumbed to a knee. Rick Aguilera was another casualty, and Cohn was out 3 months. All this, plus the early season loss of Gooden. It was up to the offense to carry the team, and newly acquired outfielder Kevin McReynolds did his share with 29 homers and 95 RBIs, and nary a discouraging word. Howard Johnson began to emerge as a star with 36 home runs and 32 stolen bases. Hojo joined the likes of Aaron, Bonds, and Mays in the 30-30 club and sashayed into the hearts of New York fans.
They're standing all over this ballpark and applauding the season that Johnson has had.
And thanks to Daryl, the Mets became the first team ever with two 30-30 members. No question, the Mets offense had style. Buoyed by their bats, the Mets entered a September series with St. Louis, just a game and a half behind the first place Cardinals. Up by one with two outs in the ninth inning of the opener, the Mets could sense the kill. Then, a Terry Pendleton home run that tied the game. A game the Cards would later win. A game from which the Mets would never recover, finishing with 92 wins, three short of what they needed to repeat as champions. ...1988 brought the 25th birthday for Shea Stadium, with new paint and a facelift part of the celebration. But there were also changes being made at the upper levels of the Mets organization, with Nelson Doubleday and Fred Wilpon agreeing to share in future Met fortunes, and along with Frank Cashin, hoping to maintain the good times. And no one had a better time in 1988 than David Cone. Cone emerged as a quality starter with a 20-3 record and a fan club that made a point of saying thanks. Cone's numbers were certainly impressive, but in 1988, the Mets made sure another pitcher's number would not be worn again. Tom Seaver returned to have his number retired by the Mets and responded in classic Seaver fashion.
If you just allow me one moment, I'm going to say thank you in my own very special way. And if you know me, how much I love pitching, you'll know what it means to me.
It was a terrific moment for Tom. But as the season progressed, the Mets were pretty terrific too. Fueled by Mookie's desire and a 39 home run performance by Darryl Strawberry, the Mets won 30 of their last 42. The key to that run was the kid from Tidewater, Greg Jeffries, who had 35 hits in 29 games, including 6 home runs. No question, the Mets minor league star had made a major league impact. The quiet consistency of Kevin McReynolds also continued, with Mac hitting .288 with 27 homers and 99 RBIs. And once the Mets had the lead, Randy Myers kept it. The lefty stopper with the blazing fastball had 26 saves and an incredible 1.72 ERA. On its 25th birthday, the Mets had done Shea Stadium quite proud. And so it was on September 22nd, the Mets pulled another one out of the hat.
Second time in 3 years.
But all was not perfect in Metsland. As in the waning days of the season, Bob Ojeda suffered a tragic accident and was lost for the playoffs. Minus Ojeda, the Mets went into Dodger Stadium for the championship series against a Cinderella team. But the shoe was on the other foot in game one, as Carter flared a two-run double in the ninth to secure a 3-2 Mets victory.
Center field, coming quickly, Shelby diving, can't get it. Here's the throw, coming to the plate, a collision at the plate, the runner's in, Mets have the lead, Mets have the lead.
On to game two, where Cone fell prey to the heroics of the irrepressible Mickey Hatcher, leaving New York on the short end of the 6-3 score. It was back to Shea for game three, and it was Mookie Wilson who broke a 4-4 tie in the eighth, giving the Mets an 8-4 win and a 2-1 lead in the series. The doctor was in for game four and carried a 4-2 lead into the ninth. The Mets were one out from going up 3-1 when, with a man on, Mike Socia destroyed their dreams.
Way back. It may go out of here. It's gone. It's gone. The game is tied up.
Then in the 12th, Kirk Gibson untied it. With Oral Hershiser coming out of the bullpen in the 12th, the Mets stood little chance, and the series now was tied at 2. Fernandez fell victim to Gibson in game five as the Mets lost again, 3-2. Back in Los Angeles, the Mets evened the series behind Cone's pressure performance. But come the seventh and deciding game, they could only watch with a mixture of awe and frustration as the Cy Young Award winner set them down 6-0, leaving the dreams of repeating the glory of 1986 for another day. But even though another title wasn't in the offing, more than 3 million fans turned out to cheer the Mets in 1988, more than ever before. Heartfelt appreciation by their fans for an amazing era of excellence in the greatest city of all.
These vagabond shoes are longing to stray.
Throughout their history, the unique character of the Mets has captivated New York, and New Yorkers have been their heart. Together, they have ridden an emotional roller coaster that has taken them from the pathetic to the heroic, from frustration to elation. Here's to Davey, Gil, Casey, and everyone in between. The amazing Mets. New York will always love them.
My little town blues are melting away. I'll make a brand new start of it in old New York.
New York is where I spend most of my time, and I love it.
If I can make it there,
and these people are screaming,
I'd make it anywhere.
Always will be a New York Met inside of me.
It's up to you, New York.
New York treats me better than my hometown does.
New York.
The fans, they are great, and they come out in great numbers.
I'll make a brand new start of it in old New York.
Enjoyed every minute of it.
If I can make it there.
I'm proud to be a part of that organization. I would like it to be the 69 Mets, the 73 Mets, and the 86 Mets.
Come on, come through, New York, New York.
Well, I have to give it your best shot. And then you come out, number one, the Mets.
Thank you. Nice to be here on your program.